Welcome to the Virtual Memories Show. I'm your host, Gil Roth, and you're listening to a weekly podcast about books and life. Not necessarily in that order. You can subscribe to the Virtual Memories Show on iTunes, or use our RSS feed with your favorite podcatcher. You can find the RSS feed on our websites, vmspod.com or chimeraobscura.com/vm. We're also on Twitter at vmspod, on Facebook at facebook.com/virtualmemoriesshow, and on Tumblr at virtualmemoriespodcast.tumblr.com. You can support this podcast and get access to exclusive content with a recurring monthly donation via Patreon. Just visit patreon.com/vmspod and set up your level of support. Every week you'll get new material from our patron-only blog, and you'll also get to listen to my monthly bonus podcast, Fear of a Square Planet, which features extra material from our guests and is only available to supporters of the show. So visit patreon.com/vmspod and patronize me. All right, I'm recording this on July 4th. There are no fireworks at our house. We have a greyhound, Rufus T. Firefly Roth, who does not handle thunder or fireworks very well. Basically, he's spent the last two nights panicked and hiding in a corner, and will be doing so again tonight, I bet. He hasn't gotten any better. It's been 8 years, and he just has never gotten used to the boom and all that stuff. Kind of sucks. But anyway, hope the rest of you have a fun July 4th, and nobody blows any fingers off or anything like that. Work, which I've given you guys vague hints about, is getting crazier. So as far as impact on the podcast goes, I shouldn't be missing any episodes, but I will likely have to cancel next weekend's trip to Boston, where I was going to go for ReaderCon, a literary SF and F event. That's science fiction and fantasy, not some weird sex thing. Get your mind out of the damn gutter. I was hoping while I was up there to record with Kelly Link, John Crowley, Gordon Van Gelder, and do my annual sit-down with Michael Derda, but there's just no way I can pull that off logistically or even mentally. It's tough for me to change hats quite as drastically between what I'm doing at work for work and being a pleasant literary conversationalist for the show. In fact, this week's episode was recorded while I was on the road for work, but it preceded a trade show. Basically, I went up a couple days early, recorded this one and a few others, and I'm not sure if I'd have been able to do a conversation like this in the middle of do 8 hours at the trade show or conference and then go down and record. It's kind of tough. I don't know. I don't know how the rest of you do with changing hats. You know, a lot of people have to do it between work and home. This is like the third place for me, I guess. Anyway, the guest this week is Paul Mavrides. Paul is this amazing artist and cartoonist who, to be honest, I did no prep for, or almost no prep for. I pitched him a week or so before heading out to San Francisco for the bio show. He didn't get back to me until the day I was flying out. So because I had a lot of other stuff going, I didn't want to do a whole ton of prep, not knowing whether we were even going to get together. So I kind of did some rapid preparation to record with him, and also figured he's had an interesting enough life and his art is crazy enough that I could walk in with a blank sheet of paper and we could still have a pretty fun conversation. And that's what we did. We recorded at his home in the Mission District, and it's just this amazing collection of art and weird stuff all over the apartment. Now, I first got turned on to Paul's work when he was collaborating with Gilbert Shelton on the Fabulous Furry Freak Brothers comics, especially the great three-issue arc they did called Idiots Abroad, which it was sort of legendary as far as 80s comics went. Anytime anytime I would read about great influences on cartoonists in the 90s and beyond, they tended to cite Idiots Abroad, among others. If you haven't read the Fabulous Furry Freak Brothers, I'm not sure how to explain it to you. It's some really amazing stuff, but it's kind of it's kind of weird comics. It's kind of underground, which is what this whole movement started out with and where Paul kind of fits into. Anyway, Paul confirmed while I was heading to the airport to San Francisco. I headed over to his apartment and bam, we got this podcast. Here is a bio for Paul from a gallery show he did for his paintings in 2014. Longtime resident of San Francisco's Mission, ground zero of the underground comic scene, Paul Mavrides is a member of the Zap Comics Collective, as well as a founding associate of the Church of the Subgenius, a rogue psychotronic religious cult, which he still serves as official apostate. I think I pronounced that right. His many collaborators have included Gilbert Shelton, Robert Crumb, film directors Alex Cox and Ron Mann, Survival Research Laboratories, and The Residents. And he successfully fought a high-profile taxation and free speech case on behalf of cartoonists and comic book readers against the state of California. I decided not to ask him about that, although he does talk about it a little bit during the show. And now, the Virtual Memories conversation with Paul Mavrides. Let's start with San Francisco, then.
Sure.
What brought you here?
San Francisco, basically.
Yeah. You were coming from Ohio?
Yeah, from Akron. So it was the anti-Akron. It was the exotic, faraway place where things happen, and plus you can walk around without strangers throwing rocks at you and trying to kill you.
You were the weird guy?
It didn't take much back then.
Okay. Were you generally the misfit when you were
And my friends. I mean, starting out younger, it was kind of like, just a little bit difference. But, by the time the mid to late 60s came along, every strange person in this kid in the city, hung out together. So yeah. That was like an interesting thing because... a group of friends and people in this scene were from all level, all class and all cultures and backgrounds and pretty much everything. They were, outsiders no matter what the group. So, and there was a certain, unity possible, that not every little alternate thing branched off into whole sections of warring alternative choices as eventually anything happens when it grows and encompasses a large enough group of people. Mm-hmm. So, plus we're done teenagers and kids for the most part, so we didn't know anything.
You're going to be doing the standard level of dumb stuff for being a teenager plus.
We got all the noise leaking in from New York City and the coasts and all the media in between. So,
but go west was your imperative?
First I went east to Boston and lived there for a little under a year. And that was just too tough. I showed up just as winter started. And wow, I thought Ohio had winters. after a brief stop back in Akron and then a few years in Tucson, Arizona in the early 70s, I made it here. Mm-hmm. And then lived in Berkeley at first and then moved over here in 1979.
Was that like an airlock sort of thing? Like you start to get accustomed to the area?
Yeah, I decided to when I got here. It just seemed so immense. And at that point, I'd been living in the desert. So I was just thrilled. I wanted to be somewhere where, I had a backyard with trees in it and actual grass for at least a little while.
Yeah.
And then once, I realized, Berkeley's not what it was either. Although I got the tail whiff of that, San Francisco seemed more interesting. And by that point, I was starting to do regular work in underground comics.
Did you study art?
Or no.
Okay. Everything was.
Yeah, just real hard. Work and persistence. I wasn't sure if I was going to do this. It wasn't until I was actually able to support myself doing this, however modestly, that I felt comfortable with it as a...
And you were part of that, we'll say, underground scene, even though it's kind of a BS term to use, but but you're a bit younger than the, you know, the guys who kind of launched it, Crum and his
by generation. About 10 years at least.
Yes. So was there a degree that you were part of that scene while also, you know, kind of educated by it? Were you reading those comics?
Oh yeah.
In a way that, you know, because most guys, it's a full time, generation.
Yeah.
Later,
like, so. At the time I was, you know, they were cutting edge. Mm-hmm.
Was that stuff available in Ohio, or did you really find it while you were okay? So you're hanging out in head shops, is what you were saying.
Yeah, so. Although it had built up. I mean, yeah, you know, in underground press shared, you know, before even the comics, these guys were tuning up, except for Crum, who had been, like, you know, doing this from the time he was, like, really little. So, I mean, added with his talent and intellect and precocity in this, he was, like, way ahead of most other people, you know, because it takes a while to get some skill.
Yeah. How long were you? When did you know you were an artist? Basically, were you
the kid
who
was a little kid?
Yeah, you were the always drawing kid.
You know, but you know, Crum was like entranced by comics, you know, comic books specifically, yeah. And I just had a whole general kid's interest in art in general. So I wasn't, you know, to me, it's like, well, I do fine art, I do commercial art, I do comic art, I do, you know, it's all just art and style and form of media is just a thing on a palette, you know, because the whole point is, interest for me is the being creative in that area. So, and I guess being an autodidact, you know, I learned randomly, yeah. You know, by doing and teaching myself. So, and paying attention for the most part and being a hideously harsh self-critic. Yeah. So it was quite a while before I had any set of peers I felt comfortable with. And I actually had to move here and, you know, make friends with some of the guys I, you know, was reading their work back in high school, like Shelton and Spain and Crum and so on, and make friends with them, you know, and then finally, you know, and with the delay that, you know, I was almost, you know, accepted.
As a peer
themselves.
Did they have a sense of, he's a kid, but he seems to get his, you know, he seems to get what we're doing?
The comics were still coming out, yeah. And, you know, people always needed to do more, and these guys were busy, and, I mean, I met a cartoonist and longtime friend, Jay Kenney, almost the first day I moved here, because we had a mutual acquaintance in the Farside Theater who, when he found out I was moving to San Francisco, said, well, you got to go see Jay. So I was staying at a house in Berkeley and bussed over here to see Jay, and we hit it off. And at the time, he lived a few blocks from this apartment, and this would be 1975, and the conversation finally swung around to me being from Akron, and he said, oh, well, you know, I have a friend here who's also an underground cartoonist who's also from Akron, and for the life of me, I had no idea who could they be talking about. You know, I thought I knew everyone, and so we walked over to this very apartment where a friend of mine from Akron, who I had no idea had started doing comics, a woman named Rebecca Wilson, was living here. And she had kind of inherited the apartment from Trina Robbins and Sharon Rudall, who had rented it years before. So this spot had been handed from cartoonist to cartoonist until I and at the, you know, so I on my first day in town in 1975, Jay and Becky and I, like, you know, hung out here, and I had no idea I was going to end up living here in 4 years and ever since. So that was kind of an odd thing to like just walk straight into the rest of your life and not even know it.
Yeah, did you have a sense of permanence?
Not until I kind of realized that the month I moved in was the actual first active month of the rent control law, which suddenly gave me incredible rights as a tenant. Wow. And that kind of like, aha!
I'm holding on to this.
Yeah.
That's great. Yeah, did that sense of community... Did you see it carrying forward? I mean, you know, you had it in the 70s when you get here. Things started to break up, obviously.
Well, yeah. These kinds of scenes are scenes because people are all operating at the same level and seeing and socializing and working together. And so you get a kind of a pressure cooker of people, egging each other on or learning off each other or experimenting together or just being part of the group, which husbands that kind of shepherds it along, but you know, people get older and their lives get more complex. They have to do they end up doing other things.
Kids tends to be the number one,
but, or other opportunities arise, so the close proximity doesn't last, and it's almost never due to some force from the outside that conspires to break it up. Occasionally so.
Yeah.
I mean, you get Nazis smashing up all culture in Germany when they took over, or what's happened the last 20 years here in San Francisco, where...
financially it becomes a...
Yeah, the dot-com boom started it. And now the internet and tech money and is gentrifying the area relentlessly.
Yeah.
And breathtakingly through displacement of anything that is not them. Along with all the other odd changes that the net introduced, like the atomization of stores where you actually buy things, a job, carrying away jobs, with that, ordinary types of jobs. I watched, after being in this area for decades, I watched like community get decimated. When I first moved here, there was a similar thing. I was involved with, radical fringe culture of all types, and then AIDS hit, and watched,
generation just
lost dozens of friends, who just got wiped out and all that. One after another. So and noted the changes there, through that sort of thing. So now in this thing, it's kind of like an extinction event where, if people lose their apartments and they're not on this gravy train, or easily hireable by these companies, they're like banished to the moon, basically.
Yeah, we've seen it in Manhattan, certainly. I mean, everything has moved out to the boroughs.
Right.
But
L.A., it's the same thing. Seattle. I got an earlier taste of it. Where such a process had been underway for much longer than any of us have been around, and certainly older than this apartment, by centuries. One of the people that moved away from the Bay Area in the early 80s was my partner and the originator, cartooning partner, Gilbert
Sheldon. There's anything wrong with that. But
No. I'm kidding. not that it matters. No. It's just...
But Gil Shelton.
And he moved... he got fed up with this and had enough of takeoff speed that he simply jumped ship and moved to Europe. And I started being sent by Ripoff Press over there to work with them, because that was the easiest way to get us productive.
Instead of
to
have pages
us in the same room
together.
Yeah, sending pages back and forth really wasn't...
I was in Amsterdam many years ago under normal circumstances, and I remember passing a bar that actually had the all three Freak Brothers full size, well, I assume full size, about 6 feet tall, painted in the doorway leading into this place one after another.
But, oh, yeah.
Yeah, I figure you just probably got ripped off on that. And
yeah. we were over there once and found a place like that. Maybe it was that same place. And we went in thinking we could... get some
play off of
free
that.
Marijuana off that. And they didn't believe it was us. And we were sitting there at the bar, like, drawing pictures of the Freak Brothers, and they're going, yeah, I don't know, you know. And...
of course. No, you're not them. I know. Yeah, they came by last week.
Exactly. It was like that. We were like, oh.
Yeah, how did you and Gilbert Shelton begin collaborating? What was the process?
Mold. Remember? Black mold.
Black mold.
Yeah. I lived in Berkeley, as I said, and at the time I got here, the Bay Area and California was in a drought, another drought, just like now.
Yeah.
The one that went on for 4 years, and it was dry, 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 and the whole process of that went along. And one of the features of my apartment in the apartment building was there's a huge crack in the wall to the outside that you could almost, like, you know, it was a quarter inch wide.
Yeah.
And but it's a drought, so, you know, so what? Easy enough to deal with. But then it rained for the proverbial 40 days and 40 nights when it broke. And I was sitting there, you know, one evening with my girlfriend. And we went to do something. I forget. I think we had the whole style, like, mattress on the floor. Mm-hmm. We flipped the mattress over, changed sheets, and air it out, and discovered that the bottom side of the mattress had molded. And then it was this nightmare eraser head moment where we ran around and turned everything in the apartment over, and anything that wasn't facing sunlight or light from the room, you know, was getting mold on it. And so my life became a process of fighting mold. I had to wash all my long play records and I had all this art, you know, my doodles and this and that, but a considerable pile of paper that I had drawn all over. And I thought, oh, Ripoff Press, it has this 13,000 square foot, you know, warehouse. I had already, they'd already been publishing my comics and things at this point. Cover Up Lowdown was the first one. So I knew them and I was familiar, and I asked, you know, can I go in the back part of the warehouse, since you've got skylights, and lay all my artwork out until it's thoroughly dry and the UV kills all the stuff? And they said, sure. And I didn't think anything of it. And I spread all my stuff out in every direction. And this apparently gave Gilbert the opportunity to walk around and look, give it a good look, and decided I might be solid enough to keep up with him. To help get his own productivity up. So we did one story where, you know, I was just the art assistant, but I worked so hard, it just turned into a regular thing that eventually got to the point where I was co-writing the stories and pretty much splitting everything. Although... to this very day, Gilbert does all the lettering exclusively, because people recognize his hand lettering, even if they don't understand that that's what they're recognizing.
Yeah, but it's still a signature.
It has this familiar flavor to it. And I've tended to do coloring more often than not. But everything else is just the smeared back and forth process.
I shudder.
It's not like at all like Marvel or something. People have that idea where one guy does pencils and another guy rules out the borders and another guy does the lettering. And this constant throwing pieces of paper back and forth, and just pushing things to completion. And I always kind of made sure that to end up, on that project, on the Freak Brothers, or when I'm working with somebody, it's except for the certain types of things, certain types of art. It's I try to meld whatever way I'm working into a unified project, so that two different art styles aren't distracting from somebody following what the purpose is, which is in this case is a funny story.
Yeah. You know, did you find that difficult at all? Sort of suborning visually what you were doing?
No. It's
more of a challenge just to to fit.
Well, there's
not a challenge. I mean, just this is what I'm doing artistically is making sure.
Right. I was really familiar with Gilbert's work and it appealed to me. And so it was really easy to kind of adjust myself to it. I probably got better over time and he probably adjusted, absorbed things from me. I've spent so much time sitting next to him that our mutual friends can detect a faint echo of Gilbert's Texas pronunciation in my speech, even though I don't notice it at all. It becomes more pronounced if I'm actually
around each other,
around him more. But I've probably collectively going over to Paris in 2 to 3 month chunks for several decades working on that stuff.
It's a question I may as well get out of the way. Is it, you've referred to it at the present tense. Have you done any?
We hadn't done anything for 20 years.
Yeah.
there was what's probably the very last Zap comic.
Right.
I got picked to be in Zap comics. Mm-hmm. Coincidentally, almost 20 years ago, I think. Well, Rick Griffin had been killed in a motorcycle accident. Famously, at least within among Zap comic readers, Victor Moscoso and Robert Crumb were supposed to get together and work on a Jam comic. While Robert was in town, back from Europe, and Robert blew it off, and they had a small tiff that was blown up into a histrionic battle, where Rashomon thing, as it turned out, because Robert did his version of this. Of this incident, and then Victor did his, the upshot of that was Robert said, maybe I should just quit. So they all voted that they thought they needed a new cartoonist to fill in the declining ranks. So I was the only person they could all agree on. Nice. They had just about everybody in comics had was nominated, but I was the only person that they all had in common. So I found myself there. So I did my own version of this thing, tiff, since I wasn't even there. Yeah. And I ended up having Victor kill Crumb at the end by stabbing him in the head with a rapidograph, just like Robert several years earlier dispatched Fritz the Cat.
Yeah, M.K. Brown just told me, you have to come back, because I recorded with her yesterday, and she's like, Moscoso lives near here. He's so good. You have to record with him. I'm like, I figure we can put something together. That guy, I figure I kind of need to do the research pretty in depth before sitting down.
A little bit. Victor's quite good at talking about his background and mm-hmm. career, and it's quite fascinating. Well, that was one of the things that went on to go try to loop this back.
Oh, everything gets with
Zap, yeah. Merging styles is one of the best parts, really, that I enjoyed in the few issues I worked on. Where again our ranks declined even further, but people would get together as best they could, since now a couple of us were in Europe, in France, Crum and Gilbert, and a third was down in Los Angeles, where they've always been, Robert Williams.
Oh, yeah.
But at this point, people would try to, like, come into town, and we'd do a two-page jam for each new issue. And in this last issue we did, that expanded to multiple jams, because it was fun to do, and it took so long to get the comic out that we just piled these things up. But everybody just basically cuts the pages into, like, thirds or fourths, and then we literally sat around a big table, for a couple of days drawing this thing, where everybody did their own kind of, style, but it was all, like, integrated into this, dense, complex pile-on, and that was oddly like a comics version of musical chairs, because it settled down to, like, one of the guys who was out of town would always get tapped, and, like, it would start off with real random things, then right in the middle of the two page whatever it was, the things would interact with each other, and then it would reach this frenzied chaos, and then we'd leave one panel open for the last guy to, like, figure this out and give us a punchline, and that fell to Gilbert or Robert Williams, generally. It was like fun, and there it wasn't like. There was this little bit of, like, you could fool around with other people's stuff a little bit, to make it work on the page. But it really was for everybody to just kind of, like, have this thought. Every cartoonist was shining a 1,000-watt light all at once into the reader's eyes or brain.
Yeah, how much did the that sense of play matter to you? I mean, you mentioned being self-taught to begin with, so you're not coming from, like, a fixed, structured, this is art, etc. So, what was that process of learning how to, how to play on the page first, and then how to play with other cartoonists, how to play off of each other? Do you remember a moment of, I'm getting this, this is how it works when I'm kind of jamming with other artists?
Oh, well, by the time I was doing that with those guys, I was already
confident enough in what you were doing.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. I mean, I was thrilled at first, to be accepted. When I first started working with Gilbert, or the first time I sat down with Robert to do something like that, or any of these guys, really, it's like, okay, I'm going to gush,
Yeah.
I'm going to gush for 5 minutes. Like, oh God, am I thrilled to, like, blah, blah, and then I'm going to stop, and that'll be and then we're just going to draw this comic, but I got to get it out of me. So
I appreciate that, because a lot of people say, no, I don't nerd out over anybody, but everybody's got someone. And again, to you, it looked like it was early on. You got that out of your system.
Yeah. Well, I've got a lot of different types of heroes. Yeah. So, normally when you meet somebody, it's like you get to the stage, the first thing that happens is, oh, an honor to meet you,
yeah.
You don't have that, then you're kind of sitting there going, oh, I need to say this at some point, yeah. But now it'll sound stupid if I do.
Well, my fear is always the, Chris Farley interviewing Paul McCartney on Saturday Night Live thing where you're just gushing and why are you so awesome? You know, you're like, yeah. You have to have something a little more. Yeah.
Well, you know, it relieves that pressure, yeah. You know, to just go, oh, I can't even believe I'm sitting here doing this. And now that I believe it, let's just do what we're here to do.
You've been on the receiving end of that?
Yeah.
Yeah. And I wonder what that experience is.
Yeah. It's, you know, there's all ranges of it too. I mean, the oddest point was years ago when somebody name dropped me to myself since they didn't know who I was, trying to impress me that they were friends with me.
Like, I don't think that's the case.
No, and I'm afraid I was. I asked him what I was like. You know. I heard he was an asshole. You know, so no, Paul's like a really nice guy. And then at the end, of course, I proved I was an asshole by introducing myself. But I did it with a smile. Yeah. So
sorry to disappoint you, kid.
He was already, mortally wounded. I don't think that even slows people down anymore. There's so much discontinuity afoot everywhere. Mm-hmm. You know, everybody's finally achieved their own separate, acknowledged that they all live in their own separate reality. It's more to the point.
Yeah, how weird is that for you? Given, you know, your sort of standalone stuff has been this, let's say, secret history sort of thing, you know, the conspiratorial blah, blah, blah. But, you know, you just these alternate ideas of how the world runs. Now that that's become sort of mainstream, do you feel like you've somehow subverted the world in the process or not?
It makes me, since I'm actually a contrarian, want to smooth everything out into bland landscape. Yeah.
You know, because part of my lesson, since I moved into I'm a lobbyist, sort of, only in the last couple of years, and I swear there's an explanation for
it. It has to pay better than art.
Yeah, that's putting it mildly. Things that I used to ascribe to malicious intent and some nefarious super, you know, conspiracy turn out to be really easily explained by incompetence, mm-hmm. in ways that I just never thought were going to be the case. I was convinced as a paranoid that, you know, things are being arrayed against me, and realized nobody knows what they're doing, and it's kind of liberating when you hit that.
Well, point. Even when things are secretly arrayed against you, they're still incompetent. So I'm not sure, but I do know what you mean. For instance, early on, I actually did have my life directly threatened by Richard Nixon.
Feel free to tell us. That's
mentioned I was I'd stopped off in Tucson in the early 70s, yeah. And one of the ways I was slowly kind of learning my chops in an out-of-way corner where nobody would really notice, which wasn't my plan, but, you know, that's how it is. He's starting off, like, you know, and I worked with what was then the local state alternative newspaper, and alternative newspaper was the brand new thing for... Well, it's sort of a weekly, but it's but it's also sort of an underground newspaper, but not too underground.
Yeah,
you know, we're trying to like have real news and have a little credibility here, and this was like the New Times at that point, which was just starting out. Eventually, it became an alternative chain owned by a couple of its founders who turned into libertarians that swallowed up papers all the way out to the Village Voice before they collapsed. But that's a different part of it. At this point, we're like struggling along. A major victory was achieving police press passes, which had to go all the way to the Supreme Court of Arizona for the paper to be accredited as actual reporters.
Yeah.
And I was just like drawing little cartoons and ads for them and things like that, and occasional display thing, you know, trying to do my best. And I guess I was okay. And I was a member of the Tucson staff, and there was a Phoenix staff. And I got into our downtown storefront office one morning and found everybody working there gathered around a desk looking at something, and went in and said, "What's what?" And apparently what had happened was we had gotten a death threat sometime during the night where a baggie full of 45 rounds had been dropped through the door with a bullet with our name scratched, each person's name scratched in each one.
They went to the effort, at least.
And a threatening note from a group called the Secret Army Organization warning us to knock it off. This might have been 73, I think. And so you know, a Secret Army organization was familiar to us because they were a group of paramilitary terrorist right wingers, shadowy out of San Diego, who had been doing things like shooting up, literally like doing drive-by shootings of the San Diego Door underground newspaper and committing arson and things. So they were serious people, and this was disturbing because now they seem to be branching out into Arizona next door. So the bag of bullets was given to the New Times attorney, whoever that was. I tried and tried for years to get my bullet back.
I was going to see if you had a necklace.
I wanted to make it into a necklace, so, you know.
I hate the fact that
as the apocalyptic joke goes, you know, I could stop a Bible if somebody threw it at me. Yeah. But you know, it was a bit of a concern. Like, why is Nixon connected to this? Well, a year later, in Media, Pennsylvania, a group of activists broke into the FBI office and uncovered COINTELPRO. And the whole rat's nest of that, which was Nixon's secret FBI plan to break up, disrupt, assassinate, do all kinds of illegal acts and unconstitutional efforts against any of his political opponents, right down to the lowliest underground newspaper in the country, which apparently was us. And one of the ways they were doing this was running and backing the Secret Army organization. And once this stuff all hit the, you know, news, Nixon went down, you know, Watergate can opener from that, you know, Secret Army organization like went dead cold. As FBI agents everywhere were sweating away, and that was that, you know. But there it was. I mean, I wish I had that, you know. Proof. But of course, now anybody at the New Times goes, "No, we don't remember that at all." And it's like, but I held it in my hand, you know. It's not the sort of thing you forget.
Speaking of having a Bible thrown at you,
that wouldn't be the first time.
You did not co-found a church, but you graphic designed a church. Talk about the Church of the Subgenius, if you can. Just, you know, so I get basically because someone, when I was starting college, a kid tried to explain this to me, and I it was as though he was from Mars. I literally had no grasp of what he was trying to say.
Well, you can't really explain it.
And that was a thing. So I figured, you know, you, from you know, at least, you know, having designed some of the work, some of their pseudo Bible. How did you get involved with the Church of the Subgenius?
Oh,
what is it?
Well,
and do you still have people sending checks into?
I wish. But then I was always a shadowy figure, so yeah.
Don't give away
I only
much,
got the, you know, when there was a big bag of money to cut up, I got my share. But the small donations, not so much.
Mm-hmm. What was it like, though, just, you know, given the weirdness of the 80s and 90s as this
Well, the church fit right into the whole religious milieu of cults and
the televangelist thing.
Televangelism and all of that, and quacks and prophets that were going on, and but it's ostensibly founded by a shadowy Texan back in the late 50s, who was a friend of L. Ron Hubbard, J.R. Bob Dobbs, and the Church of the Subgenius began and he had a severe electrical shock when he was trying to fix his television, his cathode tube television with giant vacuum tubes in it, as such devices were composed of back then in the Dark Ages, and received a huge electrical shock, which opened him up to a certain ability to contact higher beings, in this case the insane god that actually runs this part of the universe. So he found these three fellows in Texas, the two main ones. There was Dr. X, Ivan Stang, and Philo Drummond, and they began the Church of the Subgenius as an outreach to the public to warn them about their own unique end times, which had already happened, apparently.
We're living post-apocalyptically.
Yeah, and so they needed to, one of the goals of this outreach was to finally get a reputable publisher, preferably a branch of the corporate conspiracy, to print our Bible, Book of the Subgenius. I wasn't a member at this point, but one of the ways to do that was to send pamphlets out from Texas to publishers all over, all over the place, hundreds of them, to try to, as a part of the pitch, you know, here's what our Bible will be like, and inevitably they sent one to Rip Off Press, and
we're on.
Well, it was mailed to the president and publisher of the company, a fellow named Fred, who opened it up, and I was happened to be in his office, and he pulled this pamphlet out of the envelope and looked at it for a second and went, "What is this shit?" Threw it in this trash can. And of course, you know, his reaction made me wonder, okay, what is that? And I pulled it out, and within seconds, I was falling on the floor laughing, and you know, which irritated Fred no end, you know, because he had thrown it away. And I said, oh, this is the funniest thing I've ever seen, and promptly sent them $20 for more pamphlets so I could recruit more people.
Spread the gospel.
Yeah, I was instantly attuned to it.
Now, did you have Jack Chick tracts around when you were
You
were young? We had Baptists next door, so I always had them. Nobody in my world knew anything about these, you know, as an adult. I mean, God's got no face.
I first started seeing him in the mid-70s.
Yeah. Well, which is my childhood. So, yeah, that's probably when...
you know, so my friend here, Hal, is an expert on the subject. so his recollection would be better.
Well, it was a great documentary.
I mean, when I was, you know, an impressionable teenager, I was actually... It was strange. I was back in Akron and was with some older... I was still in high school and was with some, a group of older, you know, friends, college students at their apartment or house. And the door... Somebody rang the doorbell and I was assigned, you know, go see who it is. So I went down to the door, and this would have been... 68, I think, and it was a Jehovah's Witness. This Jehovah's Witness was standing there beaming, and he had his copy of Awake, you know, with this, you know, this logo that luridly said, "Awake!" exclamation point, and on it was, you know, I think a drawing of the beast, 666, which had a triceratops head and a lion head, and a, you know, it was like just this weirdest, most messed up thing I had ever seen. I had never even heard of Jehovah's Witnesses before, and he wanted to sell me this, and I didn't have any money, and but it was so weird. And Zap Comics Zero, or number one, I think it was Zero actually, was on a little table by the front door. So, it had just come out. And so I said, "I'll trade you this for that." And he looked at it and he had the same reaction in the other direction. And so he made this trade and I went upstairs like looking at this thing. And he walked down the street like who knows what he was thinking as he was reading this Robert Crumb comic. Maybe. Both our minds were blown, as we used to say back then.
You didn't become a witness or anything.
No,
but maybe you destroyed
just like doubled down on
yeah.
I think I actually probably became a cartoonist when my parents burned my comic collection in the fourth grade, and I came home from school and went to read my comic books, and they were gone.
Oh, this was Seduction of the Innocent time, right?
Yeah, well, a little bit after that, but okay. Still within the tail end of that, yeah. Where, you know, my parents had certainly been hypnotized by that and thought, you know, comics lowered your intelligence and ruined your chances in life.
Which,
they were right.
Let's be honest.
They were absolutely right. But, you know... There you go.
At least you had a fun time along the
but
way.
But I've been paid, richly rewarded by, in turn, ruining other people's lives with my work. So, you know, it has the rewards of being a virus. You don't get a nice house, but you do wound other people.
Yeah, the satisfaction of destroying. Because they pay it forward, but
yeah.
Really backward. Yeah,
but they said, you know, well, you didn't ever have any comic books. What comic books? And I think at that point I was like, oh, so it's like that, huh?
Oh my God. Did your parents ever get what you do? Like, did you...
yeah, actually, you know? Probably about almost right away, although I had become deeply estranged due to the usual generation gap subjects at the time, almost famously so. But after a few years of that, my father taught at Akron University, and my mother was taking classes there, and I was out here doing these comics, and some of their students started coming up and going, "Oh, are you the same Mavrides?" You know, like, and then, like, you know, and then when they, you know, hesitantly said, "Well, yes," then they, you know, these kids would heap praise on my work.
Your son is awesome.
Yeah. So I'm not sure my parents understood it, but
they got to appreciate that you were doing.
Yeah, I had attention from places that this kind of thing didn't normally achieve notice. The first comic book I did with Jay Kinney was based on mocking and various types of conspiracies and some real, some not so real.
Yeah.
And we got reviewed in 40 newspapers, you know, real newspapers.
Yeah.
Which was unheard of for an underground comic book. Because it didn't have, like, sex, and it didn't have drugs, and it was just pure, like, politics, you know. Odd, but... You know, we made it funny, so.
Yeah, what was the, how did you find an interest in conspiracy theory, I guess? I mean, it's
well,
running
you know, when you go through things like the Pentagon Papers yeah. and stuff, it's clear that there's a lot of shade, you know, and, you know, I liked history as a subject and was a good, avid reader, so certain, you know, credence is lent to that at some levels. You know, it wasn't like I bought every conspiracy theory that came down the line, but I, you know.
But you want to poke at them and see, you know.
Sure. You know, some of them hold up, and some of them are like, you know, ludicrous fantasies, and some are well constructed diversions or just nonsense, you know, designed to attract gullible people or simply the output of crazy folks. There's all kinds, you know, but there is, you know, even before the Pentagon Papers, there's Ralph Nader,
sure.
you know, warning the public about a deliberately misdesigned car, right. you know, that killed people. And
an old girlfriend
with an entire conspiracy by General Motors to discredit him. So these things, you know, do happen, and, you know, it's not the only place they occur is in distant, you know, kingdoms and things, as we now know. But, again, in Tucson, I hadn't really thought too much about the Kennedy assassination at the time when I was 12
yeah.
or 11, you know, you know, Mark Lane popped up right away, but, you know, I was like kind of a kid, so it's like, okay, you know, he's being described as a nut, mm-hmm. you know, and then it kind of softened up a bit as I got older and learned more about how things really work in the real world, in newspapers and this and that. You know, there's the story you're told about how everything is run efficiently and there's no personal involvement or,
yeah.
you know, or any other reason other than the purpose, you know, the legitimate purpose of the way things are, you know, where you really learn, like, oh, well, so-and-so's drunk and they're all covering for him and, you know, and he hates people that are like this. So, like, all the stories are like that. And you know, that's like normal enough.
You start to see behind the curtain a little.
Yeah. And with the Kennedy thing, it was... came right before Watergate began, like, you know, really blowing out, which of course is talk about your conspiracies and yeah. cans of worms and things.
And the gross incompetence.
I'm there in Tucson. Yeah. I'm working for the New Times, and I borrow one of those press credentials to get into a thing. A friend of mine who also works on the paper is attending, was actually, you know, ended up being a real journalist himself. But it was a symposium that the University of Arizona Medical School was having on the famous political assassinations, featuring lectures and talks by the actual coroners in those cases, for Kennedy, for RFK, for Martin Luther King. I think Cyril Wett was the coroner for the Kennedy assassination. And at the time, you know, it's not like now. There was the Zapruder film, which was basically kept in a vault and owned by Time Warner, and they wouldn't let anybody make any copies. And they famously even switched frames in the film
yeah.
to, like, tell a different narrative. When they did reproduce it. And the best you could get would be bootlegs of bootlegs. And I had always, like, you know, conspiracyologists, oh, look, you could see in the Zapruder film, and, it, you know, you see this, like, dupe of a dupe, a million times dupe, you know, 8mm print, you know, and, like, it looks like, you know, a photo of the you know, it's film shot of of the moon inside a closet. You know, like, it's like, what am I looking at?
And no, you can see it. Though,
yeah,
right,
you can
there.
See it. It's there. You know, and even the conspiracy books that were out like had drawings of the frames. You know, which again invalidates their yeah. use as, you know, like, well, it's a drawing. Yeah, you know,
you decided what to put in.
But this guy was, because of who he was able to get a first-generation print off the original negative of the Zapruder film from Time Warner and yeah. brought it with him and then donated it to the university. And so I sat through the lecture, and that kind of, like, woke me up. And then I realized, well, it's here in the university, this film. I can, like, actually...
Yeah.
You know, go see it. So I did. I went there, and I went to the medical library, and they gave me the print, and I spent 3 days in a carol with a Moviola yeah. film owner, just scrolling through it. It took the whole first day for me to, like, people are inured to seeing violent film and acts by now, and probably that will only increase. But at the time, you know, as fringe as I was, it took me a day to get over the shock. This film was crystal clear. Yeah. You know, I was used to this smudge, this black and white smudge, and here was this nice color film where everything is in focus. The worst thing you could say about it is that, like, Zapruder gets... like
framed it all
frames it off, you know, like when Kennedy is shot the first time, you know, he's like, what, you know, and the camera dips a little bit, but then he recovers, you know, but everything is there, and it just took me a while to, like, stop reacting emotionally to it so I could just actually see what was going on, and that kind of pushed me in the direction of thinking he really is being knocked backwards, not forwards. Mm-hmm. And so maybe there's something to all this, and started delving into it. At this point, you know, it's like I never could get to the, like, you'll never find, like, who paid for it. You'll yeah. never find the trigger guys. And there's so many levels. I think most of the conspiracy, you know, parts of what people are attracted to are simply, if they are real, their attempts to divert and people's attention or misdirect them from other actual conspiracies that were, well, or just, you know, going on at the same time. Yeah. But suddenly there was concern, like, oh, now they're going to come look and they're going to find us.
Yeah.
You know, they don't even know we're here, but they're going to discover us. So we have to, like, push this, you know, out there. Yeah.
But again, no fear of...
Anyway, it's an endless source for humor.
I think when you have, you know, 3, 4, 5 dozen people firing at the same time at him, you know, it just keeps multiplying.
One of my great unfinished projects that got derailed by another adventure in my life, a First Amendment tax case with the State Board of Equalization here in California, kept me from doing this comic project, which I had co-written with the filmmaker Alex Cox, a friend of mine, and another friend, an actor named Dick Rude. We had written a 7 or 8 comic graphic novel, science fiction, time travel, conspiracy story on the Kennedy assassination. Called 1963 and a half.
I think I remember seeing ads for it when they were first promoting.
I had to rush ads out because another bunch of people had done a parody of early Marvel comics called 1963 for the same publisher. So we actually got those guys to work a little bit of our story in thinking that, okay, our comic will come out and this will all, like, you know, somehow be more amusing to everyone who reads all this stuff. But I got diverted by the tax case before. I was going to do all the artwork and everything, and that just, this legal case and fight took up my time for a good 5 years. And by the time I won and came out the other side, the economics of the comic industry had begun to collapse, and I just couldn't see how I could
put the work in.
Produce a 220-page book by myself and still pay my rent. And then God knows what the sales would be like at the far end of everything, too. Although we might have sold it for a movie. Yeah. I think Alex is probably still mad at me if I didn't draw it.
I won't ask for a reference then. You know, I'd love to record with him someday, too. But do you think of working long form, doing longer comics?
No, I don't. I'm not really a fast.
I had wondered if there's a, you know, the balancing act of the meticulousness you take and, you know, cranking out pages.
Gilbert and I did do a 100-page plus Freak Brothers story called The Idiots Abroad.
One of the great ones.
And that came out in the mid late 80s. So that was one of the early, you know.
But on your
it's
own,
a long. We thought of it as a long story, but I guess it's a graphic novel, as it were.
For marketing purposes.
Yeah.
But for yourself, had you thought of, you know, is there a Mavrides story that you wanted to commit?
No, I mean, if I had to do anything, it would be 1963 and a half. Yeah. Although it's probably suffered fatal wounds through over the 20 years, it's sat on a shelf. A variety of people and projects have convergently and independently, you know, stumbled upon jokes that and concepts that we kind of like were introducing or had synthesized culturally first. But, you know, so when your material's preempted quite naturally over, you know, you can't really shove it out there.
Yeah, no, but we did it first. Doesn't really
And then out. I haven't even looked at it. Yeah. So, I mean, it was written with a mindset of somebody who's, you know, all its cultural references in it assume a certain knowledge of the reader, which was very solid for people at that time. But at this point, I don't think, you know, I could hand the thing to a 20-year-old and expect them to get half of it. You know, not because there's anything wrong with the kid, but because all these other things have happened, and other stuff has assumed importance and so on. So, you know, it would be very obscure and kind of, so what?
Yeah. Now, talk about the balance you have of comic art, and I hate calling it fine art, so we'll just say, you know, painting.
Well, it's all kind of, I spent 3 years essentially co-directing a documentary movie with a filmmaker, a documentary filmmaker in Toronto named Ron Mann, who did met him when he was doing a comic document, a documentary about comic American comic books in the 80s called Comic Book Confidential.
Oh, I remember that,
But he approached me in the right after I finished my tax case up and was kind of going, now what? And desktop computers were just now becoming real tools that were easily accessible with some powerful programs. He contacted me and said, I want you to art direct this documentary I want to make on the history of marijuana prohibition. Okay, sure, I'll do that. You know, and you'll pay me a real job. You know, it's like, yeah, it'll be all done in 9 months.
Yeah.
You know, I said, well, okay. You know, your figures and everything, that's great. You know, but it turned out like, you know, it was like more like 3 years, as I said. And boy, you know, it was kind of like, I don't even know how I existed during all that. But my role in it just kind of got bigger and bigger, as did all the limited crew's role, everybody that gotcha. Worked on it. And it was kind of like this. You know, if we'd been making a documentary on refrigerators, I would have quit. But it was kind of like, oh, this will help make marijuana legal. You know, even though we'll regret that. So we were sucked into it. And but at a certain point, I think somebody gave me a copy of one of the new film editing programs, Final Effects, something like that. It was some powerful thing, and I had a computer that could run it, and Ron found out and goes, oh, you can do all the shots now in animation. And I was like, what?
Yeah.
So in the end, that's what I did. I produced a whole bunch of little animation shots in it using a video animation program, even though this was for a theatrical 35mm movie. So when I like ran into problems, I'd call up the tech support at this company that made this, and the guys would laugh at me.
Dude, it's and not just for go, that.
What? You're using it for what? Well, good luck with that. Which made me feel real good. Yeah. But it worked somehow. I had to commandeer people I knew that had multiple computers and kind of turn them into my own mini rendering farms, because each individual frame on a shot could take up to like 3 hours or more to like churn out, doing the computation and all that. So even though I was supposed to just be the art director, I was involved with all these other things, like basically framing. With Ron, we like blocked out the movie. We worked on script, even though there was a screenwriter doing that, and had heavy input all the way through on editing. And Ron said he would have given me a co-directing thing, but his own Canadian funding wouldn't allow that because I was American, and he would have lost all the money for,
collaborating with the...
it was supposed to go to Canadians. Right. They have the same issues up there on how the national treasury gets spent, and preferably it's for Canadians.
Promoting Canadian culture.
Yeah.
Or weed.
Yeah. Although Ron's documentaries were often about American culture, but you can make a case that carries into Canada. And it was narrated by Woody Harrelson. And, it came out in 2000, did okay. Mm-hmm. Our distributor ran off with all the profits. I learned enough from that to go, okay, I don't want to make movies anymore unless I'm the guy where I sit at a desk and everybody shows me things and I go, yes, no, make it better. And then they run off and ruin their lives doing this work, while I somehow get all the money.
And nobody seems to be offering that job.
I go figure. I looked around and saw, all the movies. I mean, I was able to do this because I watched a lot of movies and I paid attention. I learned from them, as opposed to just kind of passively watching them. I'd think about things and pay attention to direction. And it's all linked, with telling stories, whether it's writing or in comics or even through a single image. It's I've always kind of looked at what I do as communication for the most part, if I'm rather than doing something to please myself, because I'm lazy. If I think of an image or something, I don't need to make it just so I can look at it, because it's in my head. It's only when I want to share it with somebody that I kind of have to go to the effort of how do I actually get this idea out of my head and into some form where somebody else can appreciate it, even if it's to tell them what the idea is. That's the tough part. And you don't need to be, you know, it doesn't need to be an all out, you know, top, you know, great skill, a million hours of energy. If you can do the same thing in a flash, you know, and get the same effect, it's fine with me. Some things lend themselves to that simplicity and others don't.
Work that you're proudest of?
What's that?
Work that you're proudest of?
Yeah.
Is there something that really...
That I'm proudest of?
Yeah, the thing that you feel like, wow, holy shit, I nailed this, or this is, you know, why I'm doing what I'm doing?
I almost never think that. I mean...
Because then you'd quit.
Well, I mean, you know, some things people come up and go, oh, that really did something for me. Or open my eyes, or this or that, and you know, and you are not even always aware of. I'm not always even aware of that sort of thing, you know, and it can come from all different directions too. One of the proudest things, well, anytime. Whatever I've done has had some effect in pushing something forward in the world outside of art, or like I said, within somebody's own interior landscape. If I've altered, opened up some way of seeing, or made them think of something, or you know, the work, you know, one of the undercurrents in Church of the Subgenius was basically think for yourself, and all the energy in it is directed at trying to make people, you know, like not just swallow things, even though that's what the church is exactly trying, you know, like all churches. We like to brag that, of course, the cult lets you keep all of your mind, unlike the other religious cults, which we, you know, consider all other religions.
Yeah.
Even though you're still allowed to believe in as many of those simultaneously as you care to, along with whatever else your mind locks on, you know, stumbles over in its path through life. So, you know, you can believe in Batman and Santa Claus and Jesus and Buddha all at the same time, and in crystal light. Yeah. You know, because you believe in you.
That's kind
of... But my line on the Church of the Subgenius now is that it's simply a blind, because the true subgenius has almost the very first line in the very first paragraph clearly states that it's a group for people that don't join things. So, conversely, by joining it, you've shown that you aren't up to that standard. So, to my way of thinking, the entire effort has been a way to, like, it's kind of a roach motel to gather all the people who like to style themselves as subgeniuses, but aren't actually, so that we can actually get on with our true goals without the distraction of followers. And who are there merely there to pester you, to get you to tell them what to do with their lives.
And sit around bothering you with interviews like this. Well, I kid.
But this is for the cult of me.
Yeah.
or is it you? Your podcast.
I like to think I'm invisible, but, you know, people seem to keep getting ideas of who I am based on this stuff. But I think they don't, no idea where they're coming from. But. Paul Mavrides, thanks so much for coming on the Virtual Memory Show.
Sure. I can almost remember what it was I was talking about.
And that was Paul Mavrides. I swear to God, I cannot find a dedicated website for him. I've put a couple of links in the show notes for this episode so you can figure out how to get to his stuff. Mavrides is Mavrides. I always pronounced it Mavrides until the moment before we started recording when I asked him how to pronounce it. So yeah, Paul Mavrides. Look him up. See his comics, his paintings. He's done some really phenomenal art over the decades. And I think he's just an underappreciated figure in all senses of the in all areas of the art world. So anyway, after the main conversation, I asked Paul, so who are you reading? And having listened to this show, I'm sure you can imagine it was a pretty strange response. So if you want to hear what he said, you'll have to become a supporter of the Virtual Memories show and get access to our monthly bonus podcast, Fear of a Square Planet. You can do that at patreon.com/VMSpod or at paypal.me/VMSpod. I've got all sorts of goals and goodies in place for supporters of the show, including the bonus podcast, a patron-only blog, series of ebooks, and plenty more. So go to patreon.com/VMSpod and support the art of fine conversation. And if you don't like Patreon, just go to paypal.me/VMSpod and make a donation that way. If you do, you'll get access to the same material through fearofasquareplanet.com. A special thanks go out to Paul W. Jones, Michael Janizek, Fred Kish, Jonathan Kranz, Andrew Mason, Greg Tanner, Zach Martin, Kyle Peterson, and Ron Slate for going over and above in their support of the Virtual Memories show. We've got the full list of show supporters at chimeraobscura.com/VM. Now, this episode, as I mentioned, was recorded at Paul's home in the Mission in San Francisco. That was part of a pre-trade show trip, so I paid out of pocket for a night at the hotel, plus car rental, gas, etc. But the airfare was a work expense, so it wasn't as costly a trip as it could have been. Still, if you want to help defray some of my costs, please visit patreon.com/VMSpod or paypal.me/VMSpod. Our music for this episode is Nothing's Gonna Bring Me Down by David Beyerwald, used with permission from the artist. David's got a reunion project going with his great 80s band, David and David, and you can find out more and support that at facebook.com/DavidandDavidMusic. And that is it for this week's Virtual Memories show. Thanks so much for listening, and again, have a happy July 4th. I'll be back next week with a conversation with the book publisher Malcolm Margolin, also recorded during that San Francisco trip. Until next time, you can subscribe to the Virtual Memories show and download our past episodes at the iTunes store. You can also find all our episodes and get on our email list at either of our websites, vmspod.com or chimeraobscura.com/VM. You can also follow the Virtual Memories show on Twitter at VMSpod, on Facebook at facebook.com/virtualmemoriesshow, and at virtualmemoriespodcast.tumblr.com. And if you like this show, please go to iTunes, look up the Virtual Memories show, and leave a rating and review for this podcast. That'll help us build a bigger audience. Until next time, you've been listening to the Virtual Memories show. I'm your host, Gil Roth, and you are awesome. Keep it that way.